Hello and welcome to Worldviews. Again, this is the second edition. I am your host, Michael Liao. And today, this is not going to be an interview. It's actually going to be a debate over a 500-year-old controversy in the Protestant Church. This is Calvinism versus Arminianism. And for me, I'll be representing the Calvinistic side. And my friend here, Joshua Lloyd Parker, will be representing the Arminian side. How are you, Josh?
I'm doing good. How are you?
Okay, well, Josh, before we start, can you just tell the audience a little bit about yourself?
I grew up in a Presbyterian church, which is primarily Calvinist. But when I grew up and came to the Lord, I really started questioning those things and really went to the Word on those things.
Okay.
Do you want to know more about me or?
Well, I mean, it's up to you right now.
I mean, I spent some time in schools like IOP University and International House of Prayer University. I spent lots of times doing ministry in New York when I was in a school. I guess that's all. I need to know right now.
Okay. Well, Josh, you know, before we jump into the debate, I want to let my audience know that both Josh and I, we have nothing against each other. We're just letting the ideologies clash. We're just doing this debate to the glory of God. This is not about scoring points or anything like that. If I quote unquote lose this debate, you know, it's not about losing, it's about being humbled. That's the one thing. And I think that we have to have this heart in our minds. We're not there to bash people on the head and say, no, believe this or believe that. God is able to work through both groups, the Calvinists and the Arminians, to the glory of his name. And I have seen people like Wesley, who was an Arminian himself, who has done tremendous work for God. And you also have men like Martin Luther and Calvin, who have done a tremendous work for the Protestant Reformation. So, Josh, you know, just letting you know, I love you as a brother. I just love you in Christ. And I pray that for the both of us, we will do this all to the glory of God.
Yes, feelings mutual. And I always enjoy our discussion, so I'm excited to get into it and that God will be glorified in the end.
Right. And so Josh and I have debated on this issue before, and we did it over a Skype call, but finally it's actually getting recorded. So it's going to go on YouTube and Facebook, and all of Josh's friends will see it, all of my friends will see it, and probably there's going to be, hopefully, if there are going to be hundreds of comments filling up the pages. That'll be nice. So I'm going to set the clock right now to 10 minutes. And Josh, since you are the guest on my show, I want you to go first, if that's okay.
That's fine.
Okay. So I'm just going to set the timer here for 10 minutes. And Josh, whenever you're ready, go.
All right. So, I just want to start this off with just saying, you know, that God's primarily most concerned with our hearts and that we would know him and love him. And both Calvinists and Arminians can do that. So I just want to encourage everyone in that. And that's the whole reason why we even have debates, why we have home groups, why we have church. It's to love God and to know him and to make him known. So I'm just going to really, really quickly go through the 5 points of Calvinism and why I do not believe they are biblical, with no disrespect to my good friend. I just want to, and for those who don't know, Calvinism has 5 points that they feel that the main 5 points that they have. They have more than 5 points, but that's the 5 main ones. They usually use the acronym TULIP, but some don't like that acronym, but I'm just going to use that acronym because it's easy to memorize. So it goes total depravity, unconditional election, limited atonement, irresistible grace, and perseverance of the saints. Now, what does total depravity mean? So total depravity, basically, is the idea that we, apart from the Lord, are completely deprived, and there's nothing within ourselves that could save ourselves, and there is nothing at all. I mean, the Bible says no one is righteous, not one. Romans 7, I know that there is nothing good in me that is in my flesh. Romans 8, those who are in the flesh cannot please God. Romans 3 says no one seeks God. 1 Corinthians, you were alienated, you were enemies of God. Colossians, you were dead in your sins. So there's plenty, there's numerous, and there's many more verses than that, but total depravity is basically, there's nothing in ourselves. Now, the way the Calvinist would look at it is, you're so dead that there's no way you could possibly choose God. That's how God chooses you. Now, I would disagree to an extent. They would say that as Lazarus died, he was raised by Christ, and that's a picture of us. You know, we were dead in our sins, and we raised. Does a dead person have anything to do with being raised? And I think that's taking it a little bit too far. I think it's a metaphor of speech, and I think rather than though God does choose us, it's that Jesus says, you did not choose me, I chose you. I think that's very true, but it also means, but nowhere does it say that we, well, actually it does say that we can resist God. And that's where I'll go to the next point, unconditional election. Unconditional election is basically the idea that apart from anything within you, God chooses you. It's by nothing you did, by no amount of skill, by no intentions. It is entirely just based off of God's choice. And Mikey, correct me if I'm wrong at all with any of these points, or you feel I misrepresent any.
No, you're actually doing a good job.
All right, thank you. So the idea of unconditional election is he picks you apart from anything. It's just God's sovereign choice. Now, the problem with this is this creates a group called the elect. If there's an unconditional group that he elects, then that also means there's an unconditional group that he dooms. Calvin even talked about, kind of coined the phrase, doomed from the womb. So I feel that's a problem because for several reasons, but I'll get in a couple of verses. It says, 1 Peter 1:2, it says, who have been, that was the wrong verse. I wanted to quote. Okay. 1 John 6, he says, it's a verse where he says in John 6, who I call, who God gives me, I will never turn away, or I'll never throw away. I just misplaced myself. So we have the idea in John 6 that he says, I'm never going to turn away those who the Father gives me. So if the Father gives him something, he's never going to turn him away. And he says, you can't come to me unless God draws you. That's also in John 6. So the Calvinist has the idea is God has to draw you. Well, here's the thing is John 12, it says, when I'm lifted up, I will draw all men unto myself. And we also have in Ezekiel 28, I do not take pleasure in the death of the wicked. Am I not pleased when they turn from their ways and live. Ephesians 2, for it is by grace you are saved through faith. And I just want to say faith is not works. So you can't say, if it's your choice, then you're choosing, then you're the author of your own salvation. And I reject that, because faith is not works, because we are saved by grace through faith. I went a little long with the first 2 points, so I'm just going to breeze through the second two. Limited atonement, that's probably the one I would have the most trouble with. Limited atonement is the idea that Jesus died for the elect only. And that's all he purchased, and that's all he... Would you have something to say about that?
Can you say that one more time?
Limited atonement is the idea that he purchased a people, the elect.
Yes. Okay, yeah, I agree, yes.
So, 1 Corinthians, you were bought at a high price. 1 John, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Revelation 5:9, with your blood whom you've purchased a people of every race and every tribe. So we get the idea that Jesus purchased a people. They purchased someone. Now, I don't believe that it's a specific group, the elect, as a Calvinist would believe, because I believe Jesus died for the sins of the whole world. We see in 1 John, it says he is the atonement for our sins, and not just for our sins alone, but the sins of the whole world. Now, if you take a look at the Greek there, all is a holos. Forgive me if I pronounce that wrong. If someone actually knows Greek, they'd probably correct me. But you can look up the Strong's reference number. It's 3,650. Holos, all, means whole, entire, all. And komos, which is world, is the world. It means inhabitants of the world, universe. So the idea is, nowhere in the Bible does it teach that the world or means a specific elect people. So Jesus died for the sins of the world. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. So he is a sacrifice for he's atoning sacrifice for our sins of believers, and not just our sins, but the sins of the whole world. 1 Timothy 2:8, God desires all would be saved. 2 Peter 3:9, he desires that none should perish, but all should have eternal life. And is there irresistible grace? It's just the idea that God's grace cannot be resisted. And I think it's evident that God's grace is resisted all the time. Isaiah 65:2, he says, all day long I've held out my hand to a rebellious and disobedient people. And for the sake of time, I'm going to go to the last one. Perseverance of the saints is just the idea of that a Calvinist would believe, you know, people misunderstand this one to being
9 seconds, Josh. 9 seconds.
9 seconds? Okay, well, I will have to get back to that one then.
Okay. There it is. All right, so it's going to be, this is where it's going to be my turn to give my opening statement right now. Before I do, I just want to set the timer here for 10 minutes. And yes, hold on for a second. My computer seems to be lagging a bit. There you are. Okay. Okay. So, Josh brought up some very interesting points about Calvinism and how he disagrees with it. And in my opening statement, there are certain verses that I feel Josh has kind of missed, and I will be arguing from a position of the nature of man. We both Josh and I would agree that we agree on the doctrine of original sin, that both... that whether you're an Arminian or a Calvinist, both are born in sin. Both do not seek God. And as Josh even mentioned, the verses that support the Calvinistic position is Romans 3, where it says, no man seeks after God. And we actually see evidence of this. If we look at the parable of the lost coin, it is Jesus who goes after the lost sheep. The lost sheep doesn't go and find Jesus. Now, of course, in the after that parable, there's the parable of the parable of the prodigal son who comes back to his father after living in a life of sin. But we have to realize this one thing. Men, by their nature, if a person were to ask me, do you have free will? I would say, yes, your will is free, but it's only free towards one direction. And that one direction is sin. Men, by nature, love their sin. They would never repent of it. They are dead in their sins, as the Bible says in Romans, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1, for you were dead in your trespasses. So my question to Josh would be, what does dead really mean then? Does dead really mean, can a dead man really choose? If we look at Lazarus, for example, if we were to go to a graveyard right now and we were to say, Lazarus, come forth, or a dead man, come forth, he's not going to come forth. Why? Because he's dead. He is unresponsive. He has a heart of stone, as the Bible says in Ezekiel chapter 36, verses 25 to 27. And what God says in Ezekiel 36, verses 25 to 27 is, I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. Romans 8 says that it is God who justifies and it is him who glorifies. It all begins with him. And that's why Calvinism is more consistent with the gospel of grace. Why? Because it's grace. He chose me. I never chose him. And if it was up to, if God left it up to me, I would harden my heart. I would only choose sin more and more. But because of his sovereign love and his grace, and it was not dependent on my own effort, but it depended on what Christ did for me on that cross, that's where it is. That's where I can identify with myself with Christ. That when Jesus was crucified, I was identified with him in his death. It was completely his work. My sinful nature died with him. He was buried. I was buried with him. And when he resurrected, I also resurrected as well. It is not a work of our own choosing. And to mention, if we were to go to John, let me just go to John for a second. John, I believe, chapter 10, it should be. Before I go to John chapter 10, here's John chapter 3. John chapter 3, verse 8 says, the wind blows where it wishes, and you hear its sound, but you don't know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with every man who is born of the Spirit. So Jesus was essentially saying, the wind blows where it wishes. He's talking about the operating work of the Holy Spirit. This is where the Holy Spirit breaks into a man and saves him, unites him into Christ because he cannot save himself. I know that we have had many analogies in Christendom today that say it's like a drowning man who's drowning and just reaching for that rope. Well, for us, for the Calvinists, we say the man's already dead. The man has already drowned. And that the only way that a man can ever live is if life was given to him from the outside. And that's why salvation is of the Lord. Psalm chapter 3, verse 8. It does not depend on man. Philippians 2:13. For it is God who works in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure. So a man who is dead will not recognize his state. It's only when he has been awakened by the Holy Spirit. That's when he knows. Now, I know that Josh says in he's against irresistible grace because, because grace can be resisted. And sure, in the Bible, there are examples of grace being resisted. But here's the problem, is that if man was left to himself, he will always resist him. He will always. We're arguing from a position of nature right now. Man in and of themselves will never choose him. And so, if I can just find John 10 right now, I'm just going to go there. John 10:26, it says, but ye believe not, because ye are not of my sheep, as I said unto you. The reason why the Pharisees did not believe on Christ is because they were not of his sheep. Jesus does not need any of us to say, okay, I'm going to get choose to be his sheep anytime I want. No, he's the shepherd. He is the one who chooses his sheep. And some people might be threatened by that. But the reality is, it's actually the most freeing thing. A person who's threatened by this is actually having his self-determination being ripped away, because in and of himself, he cannot try to somehow constrain the work of the Spirit in himself. But the man who is actually thrilled, but a man should actually be thrilled about it, because it's actually saying, I'm a slave of my sin. I can't save myself at all. If God left me to myself, I would die. I would be done. If God never grants me repentance, I would never repent. And that's why it is totally dependent. And that's where faith is, totally dependent on the grace of God. Romans 9:16 says, so then it does not depend on the will of man or exertion, but on God who has mercy, on him who has mercy. And so that's why the Calvinistic doctrine is the gospel. It actually gets man to come to God as himself, come as you are, so that realizing that he cannot save himself, he cannot clean himself up, he can't even believe on Christ. It's not dependent on your faith, it's not dependent on your repentance, it's dependent solely on grace. That's why we, in the Protestant Reformation, it has always been sola gratia, sola grace, or soli Deo gloria, glory to God alone. And that is Calvinism right there. No man can come unto me unless the Father draws him. Again, we see that if we were to just simply preach the gospel to a person, if he was left to himself without the Holy Spirit, he would never turn. Without the sovereign work of regeneration, to take out that heart of stone and give him a heart of flesh, a heart that is repentant, a heart that is willing to submit to the lordship of Christ, it is impossible. So I'm arguing from a position that regeneration precedes faith, not the other way around. So that's why we say, for by grace you have been saved through faith. It is not of yourselves. It is not of yourselves. That's what the Bible says. It is a gift of God. Faith is also a gift of God. And so that's why I disagree with Josh's position, because if a man is dead in the sin, and not only he's dead in the sins, he loves his sin, he can't hate his sin. And that's why God has to create in him a clean heart. And so that is in itself consistent with grace. It is consistent with grace. And also in Acts chapter 17, verses 25, it says, God is not served by human hands as though he needed anything. Also in Isaiah 63, verses 15, I know that Josh quoted the book of Isaiah, but that he held out a hand to a rebellious nation. But there's also, actually no, 59:16, sorry. It says, he saw that there was no one. He was appalled that there was no one to intervene. So his own arm achieved salvation, and his own righteousness sustained him. So God, yes, sure, he reached out to a rebellious nation. But at the same time, though, this verse also says that he's the one who can reach down and bring salvation to the nations and to individuals like Josh and myself. And that's why I have to argue, God, if he leaves me to myself, I would be done. And that's it. Okay, and let me see. Josh, you have 10 minutes of rebuttal. Go ahead.
All right, awesome. Well, I just want to say that it is a great pleasure to have this debate, and a great joy. And I just want to reiterate how much I honor my brother. I'm just going to finish off Perseverance of the Saints. Really, just the basic idea is that they believe that the one who perseveres till the end is the one who's actually saved. And on that, I would just like to say that you can be cut off. There can be a one time that you are saved and that you are not. By many scriptures, Revelation 3:5, it talks about, he's talking to a church being victorious, and it says, to the one who is victorious, I will never blot out their name from the book of life. So if you're not victorious, then that must mean that your name can be. 2 Peter 2:20, it says, if they have escaped the corruption of the world by knowing the Lord, so they escaped the world by knowing the Lord, and are again entangled in it, they are worse off than at the beginning. So it's the idea of, he was once lost, he came to know the Lord, I mean, that's what the verse says, and then it says, and they got entangled, and that they're worse off than when they began. Colossians 1:22-23, he says, he's able to present you blameless and spotless, without reproach, if you continue in the faith. So there's a real part that you have to play. And Romans 11, of course, talks about being cut off if you do not continue in the faith. So that's on the perseverance on the saints. Now, with the rebuttal, I'd have to say that that there are many points that Mikey made that I'd like to address. He had the question of, what does it mean to be dead? Well, obviously, it's a figure of speech that Scripture is using, because there's exceptions where dead people are actually raised, but it's using a type of language. It's saying this is what you were, and there's nothing in yourselves that could save yourself, and that God alone had to raise you. Now, I don't think he would disagree with that, but I think there's also other scriptures, and you can't take that one metaphor and take it too far, because there's other scriptures that say that you can fall away, that you can run away.
Go ahead.
All right, so in Leviticus, Leviticus and Deuteronomy, those whole books, they're books where he's talking about, if you do this, if you obey me, there'll be blessing. And if you turn, if you're disobedient, there's going to be curses. So there's this idea that, you know, those who obey, they will get a blessing. Those who don't, they'll get a curse. Now, why do I bring that up? I bring that up because there's a real choice. He says, choose this day whom you will serve. The entire Bible sends out invitations to us. Now, why would there be invitations if there was only a select group? The invitation, he's calling out to everyone. And Acts, it says, God desires that all are, no, God calls all men to repent. Why would he call to repent if he's not enabled to repent? If God calls to repent, he enables us to repent. How do we believe if there's nothing in ourselves, if we were dead? Well, because faith comes by hearing, and hearing the word of God. If the word of God is preached, it creates faith, and God really gives up an ability to choose. Love cannot be coerced. That's why that he created the world. God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whosoever is not a certain people, the world is not a certain people, it's whosoever, I think that's safe to assume, it's whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. So we have a real choice, we have a real opportunity, that the invitation is open for all. Matthew 23 is at the end after Jesus rebukes all the Pharisees and says, woe to the Pharisees. He then goes and he says, he mourns and he weeps over Jerusalem. And he says, oh, how I longed to gather you, but you wouldn't let me. You refused. Now, why would he say you refused if in fact they are doing what they, if they didn't have a choice. So I would say that because the Arminian would look at it like this, is did God, I didn't choose God, he chose me, of course. He is a bridegroom, and he presented himself to me. He asked for my hand in marriage. I know that's weird because I'm a guy, but you get the picture. is that when he offered that, I really had a choice to say no. And that's a picture, because it's all about love. It's all about a relationship, and love cannot be coerced. It cannot be fixed. Love is really, is the very definition of love is the choice of affection. So that's where I stand. How am I doing on time?
Let me see. You have 3 minutes and 24 seconds.
All right. So I want to touch on God-focused salvation versus man-focused. Now, many Calvinists would say that an Arminian view is more of a man-focused salvation. And I would disagree. If you had a man in the lake crying out, you know, help me, and he couldn't swim, and there was sharks, or there aren't sharks in a lake, but you get the idea. Now, if someone throws him a rope and he grabs the rope and is pulled out, he's not going to say, I did it. You know, no, he's going to thank the man that threw him the rope. No one has a testimony where they said, yeah, I accomplished it. No, it's all about the Lord and how great he did. And it's entirely based on the Lord and his goodness and his gracious gift to us that he lavished freely. Also, on the atonement, the limited atonement, I would also like to raise the question of 2 Peter 2:11, talking about false prophets who were denying the Lord who bought them. Now, if they were false prophets, they couldn't have been believers. So, why did the Lord? How could the Lord buy them? Well, in fact, he bought the whole world. He purchased us, but it's actualized by faith. We are saved by grace through faith. It's not of ourselves, but that no one would boast. It's not by works, but it's him alone. Jesus did it all on the cross. How am I doing on time?
You have, 122.
122, awesome. Well, I'll just surrender the rest of my time because
okay.
I have the rest of my notes.
Okay, then. All right. Well, you sure about this? You don't want to continue?
I'm sure.
Okay. I all right. Well, Josh. Josh. Thank you for your rebuttal. Again, I want to reiterate the point again that Josh said. I honor my brother in what he's saying. That yes, the Bible both stresses on the sovereignty of God and also the responsibility of man. Now, I want to respond to the first thing that he said in his rebuttal about 2 Peter 2:20, and also in 2 Peter 2:11, where it says the people who were bought by the Lord and also who were somehow bought by the Lord and then they became false prophets. Now, let's read, but then in the same verse, in the same chapter, this is what it says. If they have escaped the corruption of the world by knowing our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and are again entangled in it and are overcome, they are worse off at the end than they were at the beginning. It would be better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than to have known it and then turn their backs on the sacred command that was passed on to them. Now, verse 22, this is what I would believe that should have been quoted. It says, of them the proverbs are true. A dog returns to its vomit, and a sow that is washed returns to her wallowing in the mud. So remember, in the gospel, we don't have just the doctrine of justification. We also have the doctrine of regeneration. Regeneration is when God takes out the heart of stone, gives a heart of flesh. He removes that old nature by crucifying it on Christ and basically giving us the resurrected life in us so that we have a new nature. So the people who, in 2 Peter, which was addressing the people who were supposedly bought by the Lord, those were false professing Christians. A tree is known by its fruit, as Jesus says. You can tell the tree is talking about nature again. If I, let's say, for example, have a pig right in front of me, and I have Cantonese chow mein on one side, and I have pig slop on the other side, what's the pig going to go up to? It's going to go to the pig slop, because by nature, it loves the pig slop. Its willingness is towards, its will is moving towards the pig slop. But what if I have, and this is Charles Spurgeon's analogy, if I had the power to snap my fingers and say, and make this pig turn into a human being, it's going to come out of that slop feeling disgusted. Because why? Because, as it says in the Bible, those who are in Christ Jesus are new creations. The old has passed away, the new has come. And that can only be given by God. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but spirit to spirit. It's the Holy Spirit that gives the life of Christ into the believer. So now, I know that Josh touched a lot on the perseverance of the saints, so let me touch on that for a moment. Jeremiah chapter 32, verse 40, it says, I will make with them an everlasting covenant, and that I will not stop doing good to them. But then the second part of that verse says, I will put the fear of me into their hearts so that they will not turn away from me. So there is that concept that when God saves the believer, he puts the fear of him, this reverence of him into the believer's heart so that they will not turn away from God. And that can come by the warnings that Josh was talking about. Now, there are certain warnings in the Bible that Josh would mention that supposedly a person can lose their salvation. Well, let's look at Hebrews chapter 6, verses 4 to 6, that for if those who have once been enlightened by the Holy Spirit and then have fallen away, they cannot be renewed unto repentance. Well, again, that is talking about a person who looked like they were regenerate, but then they weren't. A regenerate person will all, as it's, even though Josh says, if they continue in the faith, the person who continues in the faith proves that they had the sovereign work and grace of God done in their life. It does not depend on man whatsoever. And that's the beauty of the gospel, is that it, we are responsible in our sanctification. Work out your salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure. At the same time, though, the true believer who has a new nature will continuously grow in his grace and grow in holiness to the end of his life. And as Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25 says, that he saves to the uttermost. To me, it would be kind of insulting to say that you can lose your salvation, because you're essentially saying that God is not powerful enough to keep you all the way to the end. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, 8, if I can just go there for a second. 1 Cor 1:8. Before I go to 1 Corinthians 1:8, there's also another one, Philippians chapter 1, verse 6. It says, and he who began a good work in you will finish it. That's not based on any will of my own. That is completely dependent on the promise of God for the believer. Also, here it says in 1 Corinthians 1:8, he will also keep you firm to the end. He will. He says, he will also keep you firm to the end, so that you will be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. So again, this is completely a work of grace. God puts his laws into man's heart. And now to respond to limited atonement about Christ dying for the whole world, and I understand that in 1 John that, you know, he did not only die for the sins of the believer, he died for the sins of the whole world. In what context is the word whole world used? The phrase whole world. You look at, for there's a passage in the Bible that it says, word of your faith has gone out into the whole world. So does that mean that during the time of the early church that that people in China heard exactly what the gospel was and the word of their testimony? Absolutely not. In fact, Christianity only came to China probably in the Tang Dynasty. That's, I believe, in, I know, I'm not sure if that's the 900 ADs. I have to go check. But we have to understand in what context is the word whole world used. And secondly, if we really believe that Christ died for everybody, then the fact is his blood purchases for us repentance and faith. It purchases for us the full salvation and the full benefits of God. Then why is not everybody saved then? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that everybody is going to be saved. And going to unconditional election, which is consistent with limited atonement, we have to ask the question, is God just in saving a person and also just in not saving a person? And the answer to both questions is yes. He is just in saving a person, giving a person what they don't deserve, and he can also give a person what they do deserve. If we actually read in Romans chapter 9, and Romans chapter 9 talks exactly about the salvific work of God, we go to verse 22. It says, "What if God, although choosing to show his wrath and make his power known, bore with great patience the objects of his wrath prepared for destruction? What if he did this to make the riches of his glory known to the objects of his mercy, whom he prepared in advance for glory?" In advance. So basically, before the foundations of the world, as it says in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 to 4, as it says, "Blessed be the God of our Father, of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in Christ, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world." So if it was really dependent on free will, then I have to somehow cooperate with God's grace in order to be chosen. But the fact is, as the Bible says, many are called, but few are chosen. Many have heard the gospel call. And yes, God invites everybody, but few are chosen. Few are truly regenerated by the grace of God in order to live a righteous life. In Titus chapter 3, it talks about not by righteousness and works of our own, but by grace and grace alone. He was the one who drew us in to begin with. And so, no one comes unto me unless the Father draws him. And because we would never come to God. No one seeks after God. So, yeah.
All right.
Okay, hold on. Okay, so 10 minutes of cross-examination. Josh, I will give you... let me just run this timer. And your 10 minutes start now.
All right. So, with 2 Peter 2:11, when it talks about the false prophets denying the Lord who bought them, so do you believe the false prophets are believers?
No, because a person who denies the lordship of Christ basically has never truly known him. If we go to 1 John chapter 3, let me just turn in my Bible here. Man, it's hard to search on the internet doing this. 1 John chapter 3. 1 John chapter 3 says, "Everyone who makes a practice of sinning also practices lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. you know that he appeared in order to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him keeps on sinning, and no one keeps on sinning has either seen him or known him. So the person described in 2:20 and 2:11 is talking about a person who has heard the gospel. It's kind of like a jail cell. They ran out of the jail cell, but sooner or later, their nature is going to catch up to them.
So, I get that part. So, did the Lord buy them?
Did the Lord buy? In the context of that verse, no, because if he had truly bought them, they wouldn't be the false prophets. So when it's talking about being bought, he's speaking in the context of these people look like they're bought. They look like they were true Christians. They endured for a while, but in the end they fell away. So it is consistent with Matthew 13 when it talks about the rocky ground soil. The person endures trials for a while, but underneath that soil, there's still that hardness, and that's a person who has never fully submitted themselves to Christ, and because they don't have the nature to do so. So, no, they have not truly been bought.
Okay, so the false prophets denying the Lord who bought them, so you disagree with that verse, all right? All right, so the Bible gives a lots of warning. In the New Testament, there's over 80 warnings. Why all the warnings? Every book in the Bible gives a warning. Why all the warnings?
Right. The warnings are there because, as you know, consistent with Jeremiah 32:40, that God would put his fear in the believer's heart so that they would not turn away from him. The warnings, you know, like if they would continue in the faith, or Hebrews chapter 6, or Hebrews chapter 10, if we can continue sinning deliberately after receiving the knowledge of the truth, there remains no more sacrifice for sins. But at the same time, though, if we look at the book of Hebrews, you know, all the warnings. Now, the warnings are there, of course, and I would agree with you. It does show a possibility that you know, it's to warn the person of a possibility that they can fall away. But the true believer, if you read Hebrews chapter 10, in the very same chapter, verse 38 to 39, it says, "Yet a little while, and the coming one will come and will not delay, but my righteous one shall live by faith, and if he shrinks back, my soul has no pleasure in him." But this is what he says. He affirms the believer here. "But we are not of those who shrink back and are destroyed, but of those who have faith and preserve their souls." So this is a work of true faith, and that's a grace of God that the warnings are there to help the believer to persevere in the faith. And the warnings are there for those who play with sin. Those who play with sin, I would highly doubt that they were even saved to begin with, because I would highly doubt their salvation because they're loving their sin.
I believe you answered the question. So if you have unconditional elect, if you have the elect, then you have to have the reprobate. Like,
yes.
There's no way around that.
Right.
So if I'm a parent and I give birth to a doomed child, as Calvin said, and there's nothing I can do, no matter how much prayer or, you know, how much I invest the word and disciple them, they're doomed for hell. Should I rejoice in that?
Well, it's not should I rejoice in that. It's so much what does the Bible say? Because here's
if
the...
God does it, I should rejoice, though, right?
Pardon?
If God's the one doing it, because everything he does is good,
well,
then I should...
Well, here's the thing. I remember there was a man who prayed this one prayer and basically said God, and his son was living in sin during the time the father is the pastor, and he said, "God, you know, you would be just in sending my son to hell because you are righteous and you are holy." You know, the fact is, the fact is, we don't deserve what we get. And so the thing is, the father said, "God, if it's in your will, please save him. And God had mercy on his son in the end, and God saved him and sovereignly, supernaturally saved him. And of course, you know, we hope for the best. But at the same time, though, we trust in God's sovereign plan. Then shall not the judge of all the earth do right? So yes, in a sense that for me, it's not so much that I rejoice in what God is doing. It's more like I trust what God is doing. And if he is sovereign in the salvation of a person, then yeah, because it says in the word, therefore God has mercy on whom he has mercy, and he hardens whom he has whom he hardens. So I have no control over that.
All right, I'll accept that. Do you believe that God loves? Do you believe love can be coerced?
Love can be coerced.
Yeah, like, God coerces us.
Like he forces. Okay. Technically, if I'm arguing from a position of nature, yes. And the reason is because if I was, again, left to my own will, I would never choose him. And I know that, yes, you know, the Bible has the image of, you know, God proposing to the person. But without God, as much as we say that love is not coerced, the problem is we are the ones that hated God. And right. So we're the ones that hate him in our unregenerate state. So the only way possible is if it's not in a sense that it's coerced, but it's more that he changes our will and our heart. As the Bible says, for it is God who works in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure. Romans chapter 9 says, so then it does not depend on the will of man or exertion, but on God who has mercy. So...
All right.
That would be the answer, yes.
Okay, well, we focused a lot on election and everything, but I also want to talk about God basically predetermining everything. You believe, like, God did predetermined everything before the world, like, to the small speck of dust going...
Yes.
So I guess my question is... In verses like I believe it's in Jeremiah or maybe it's Ezekiel when they're sacrificing children to Moloch, he says this never entered my mind, you know, this was never the intent I had for you. I mean it in Genesis 6 when he said men were full of wickedness, and the thoughts and the intents of their hearts were only evil continuously. It says God was sorry that he made man. Now why was that if he predetermined it?
Right. You know, with this question, I mean, I'll admit I do not have, you know, a full answer to this, but I can only speak from what the Bible says about this very issue. We both see in the Bible that we see the sovereignty of God, and we also see the responsibility of man, that man is also responsible for their sins. Even though he predetermined things to happen, at the same time, though, it's not that he forces a person to sin. It's more like he lets man go to see exactly what happens. If I read, for example... Romans 9:19, I can only answer this from a biblical perspective. It says, it does not therefore depend on human desire or effort, but on God's mercy. In verse 17, this is what it says. For scripture says to Pharaoh, I raised you up for this very purpose, that I may display my power in you, that my name might be proclaimed in all the earth. But other than that... who are you, O man, to answer back to God? That would be my response to you, because we cannot. God can do whatever he wants with his creation. Okay.
All right.
Okay. So it's my time to cross-examine Josh. My 10 minutes begin now. So, Josh, my first question for you is, how do you see Romans chapter 9, verse 16, that... so then it does not depend on the will of man or exertion, but on God who has mercy.
Mm-hmm. I agree with that verse. I don't see where would be the problem for that for an Arminian.
Well, in a sense that, you know, my question is, can a dead man choose God?
Yes. If God, in fact, if he draws us, and, you know, we know in John 12, he says, if I be lifted up, I draw all men unto me. So I believe that the Lord calls all of us, and again, if he calls us all to repent, then he enables to repent.
Yes, but what about then in its consistency with the other verses in Romans 9 where it says, I will have mercy on whom I have mercy, and I will harden whom I harden?
Yeah, I mean, that fits in my theology. I mean, I don't feel any problem with that because God is choosing. There's a group that is resisting him, and there's a group that is obeying him. So he's choosing one group, and he's choosing another. And you see that throughout the book of Romans. He's talking about two different categories, the Jews and the Gentiles. Okay. And he's talking about who he's choosing to have mercy on. Who he's choosing to damn.
Now, before Moses went to Pharaoh, I know that many argue and say that the reason why God hardened Pharaoh's heart was simply because Pharaoh started it first. Or in other words, Pharaoh was the one who hardened it first. Yeah. But even before that whole incident, God already said, he already promised in his sovereign decree that he was going to harden Pharaoh's heart. How do you deal with that?
When does he say that? What verse does he?
I'm just going to have to go before Exodus. I'm going to have to go into Exodus. Let me see. Exodus. I believe it's in, I'm not sure if it's in 2 or 3 or 4. I have to check this out again. This is going to be a long, yeah.
The short answer is that you see that a lot is God uses the wicked means of men and the free will of men and Satan's rage to further his purposes on the earth. Now, I guess the difference between you and me is we both believe God is sovereign. It's just the different ways we would think about it. I would view it more as like if it was a chess game, God would move both pieces for a Calvinist and correct me if
so then does man, so then does man ever have a choice then, because ultimately it's him who moves the pieces.
I mean my view of the chessboard is that yes, the man gets to move his own pieces, but God's still in control and he still has the end result in the game. And he's a million steps ahead of us, and he knows when to raise up a man to further his purposes who is even wicked, and he'll even help him in it, but he's not forcing that man to do it.
Okay, well, do you believe then that if a man is left to himself, that he'll be able to choose God?
By himself, no.
Then wouldn't that be consistent with the doctrines of grace, because it is God who justifies and it is he who glorifies? That's the golden chain of redemption in Romans chapter 8.
Yeah, I would agree with that, but I don't think in that golden chain of redemption does it mean that it's automatic and, you know, it's unbreakable, because then you'd have to throw away lots of other verses that, you know, I believe. I mean, we're getting back into can you lose your salvation again? Because, and one of my main points for that is because if that's the case, then right away when you get saved, you be glorified. And that's not the case. Well, we know sanctification is a process.
Right. Well, that's, you know, obviously we have a disagreement on that. I would say that, you know, we do emphasize on human responsibility is just that if man was left to himself, he can't be good. He can't be good. The question is now, no one can come unto me unless the Father draws him, right? So can man come to God if God doesn't draw him?
No, absolutely not. But he draws all men into himself, John 6, or sorry, John 12.
Right. So then, but then here's the problem then. With one side, even though he does draw all men unto him and only a few are saved, and his blood is effectual in regenerating the heart of man, then wouldn't you agree that that there is an effectual grace for only for a certain group of people because they were the ones who could only receive salvation? A lost man can't.
Yeah, I mean, sure he can. I mean, in the sense that, you know, if the word's preached and the invitation's given, that the Lord will give grace to do it. I mean, it's really simple to me because I just read the verses and I just say, okay, that's what the verse says. Whomever wills. I mean, how many times does Jesus in the gospel say, whomever will, you know, it involves an interaction, an invitation. I mean, why would the Lord invite if there wasn't, in fact, an invitation?
Right. Now, let's move on to, let's see, the perseverance of the saints. I know that you have a bit of a problem with that. How do you see verses like Jeremiah chapter 32, verse 40, where it says, I will put the fear of me into their hearts so that they will not turn away from me?
Yeah, I think that's an awesome promise. But I don't think that, you know, I don't think that it's saying that there's no possible way that you will never turn away from me. Because I know, and I already gave you the other verses. I could give you to them again, but that you can turn away. So I believe that on God's end, yes, absolutely, I can have perfect trust in His promises, and I can walk in that. You know, and I don't have to be afraid that, you know, oh, am I saved? You know, God's not writing my name in the book of life with a pencil. You know, and if I mess up, He erases it. You know, I would have to do something drastic, like deny the Lord or something along that side. I can be fully assured in His ability. But, you know, Calvinists would like to say neither height nor depth nor anything else in all creation could separate us from the love of God. Right. Amen. I say amen to
right.
that. But the reality is I can still turn away from Him.
Then how do you interpret a verse like 1 John chapter 2, verse 19, which says, which basically says they went out from us because they were never of us, never. That means that they...
I think that there are there's a definite group that, you know, would appear to be Christian that never were. But I don't think just because of that verse, that means everyone who fell away from the faith never was, because then that would contradict, I mean, the Second Peter 2:20, those who weren't. I mean, you have to balance scripture with scripture.
Well, since you mentioned Second Peter 2:20, you know, let's go to the other two verses after that. There is also the verse 22, which says they are like. Hold on for a second. Let me just go back here. There you go. Where it basically says, of them the proverbs are true. A dog returns to its vomit, and a sow that is washed, a sow is a pig, that is washed returns to her wallowing mud. So the question is then, were they regenerate? Because this is talking in terms of nature now.
Definitely, because it says they who knew God, who knew our Lord. So they know Him. I mean, that's what the verse says.
Right.
And it was worse for them.
Right. It says knowing, and that's because, of course, like, it is in line with Hebrews chapter 6, where they have been enlightened. But remember, when it's saying a dog returns to its vomit, it's saying that the nature hasn't really changed. And so as much as they have come to know, I mean, how can you say that they are still regenerate?
Because I mean the verse right there it says it'd be worse off for them than it was. So they were a dog and they were dead.
Okay. All right. Well, this section is over. The cross examination is over now, and now I will Now we are going to do 10 minutes of closing statement, and I want Josh to start first, and I will end off with my closing statement. So, Josh, whenever you're ready, you can start now.
Well, I said it before, but I'll say it again. It was a great joy to debate such a brother that I honor, Mikey. Honestly, there was many points that you're making that I was agreeing. Like every time you're talking, I was agreeing and amening. Because there's actually much more I agree with you than I disagree. I was starting to fear that I agreed too much. but overall, you know, we want God to be glorified. Amen. And so in the end, you know, me and Mikey are by no means any experts. I suggest the best teacher there is the Holy Spirit, right, and the Word. Go to this stuff yourself. Don't take my word for it. Don't take Mikey's word for it. Don't even go to the professors for it. I mean, it's good to hear from them, but if that's the primary source that you're leaning on and trusting in, then there's a problem. And I know Mikey would agree with that, is we need to fully trust and believe him. He is the best teacher you could ever have, and he's the best person you could ever put your trust in. To close, I just want to say that there are many, I feel I've already made my points of why I believe Arminian's true. I just want to say, what is the positive that we can both get out of this? Because if you get too tangled up into this, you can forget about reaching the lost. And, you know, whether you're Calvinist or you're Arminian, you know, that doesn't affect your witness to your neighbor. You know, so don't, if this all seems confusing to you, don't get hung up on these things, and just preach the gospel, the simple message that to repent and believe and trust in the Lord Jesus, live for holiness, pursue Amen. Him, turn from sin. Repentance, the Greek word is metanoia, change your way of thinking, change your mind, and turn from your wicked ways, and trust and fully believe in God. I believe that there are many strengths in the Calvinist view, and I would point them out. There's a strength is they're very God centered. They want they hate I don't want to say they hate the words of men, but above all else, I believe that they'll quote Bible verses to you, and I honor that, even though I disagree with a lot of the interpretation that's coming. I'm very happy that they bring something to the table, and that I can honor that, and I can honor my brothers despite and love them despite our differences. So I just want to encourage people to continue. If you're interested in going deeper, James White and yes. Dr. Brown have yes. an awesome many discussions. You just YouTube it, and they have awesome discussions. And I just want to encourage you to go. Don't take it from me. Search and see. How about that rap, huh?
Yes.
Yeah. So, how much time do I have left?
6 minutes.
6 minutes. Okay, well, I don't have yes. 6 minutes left to say, so I'll turn it over to you.
Okay, well, Josh, thank you so much for your points, and I'm just going to reset the clock here. All right, 10 minutes. And thank you, Josh, once again for doing this debate with me. I am so glad that I got to do, you and I can converse on this issue and dialogue over this. Some of the points that Josh made that were so valid, he really emphasizes on the responsibility of men, and that is emphasized in the Bible. We are to call men and women and children to repent of their sins and believe the gospel. But, of course, we cannot do that apart from the sovereign grace of God. I honor my brother in that. Both of us preach the same gospel. We agree on the essentials. The Calvinism and Arminianism, that's only, how can I say, that's like secondary stuff. So, you know, the essentials would be, you know, we believe that God is the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We believe that men are sinful, men are born in sin, and that the only way that they could ever be saved is through Christ and Christ alone. Probably, maybe for some of you who heard this debate, you might be hearing that, for example, you might be hearing both Josh and I, we might be actually claiming the same thing, but at different points of emphasis. That might be the case. Now, to the points that Josh were making in this debate, I do respectfully disagree with him, especially on the whole perseverance of the saints. For example, there are verses in the Bible that says that they went out from us because they were never of us. And the ones who basically practice sinning and that they continue in sin, if they go back to sin, it says that they have never seen God nor known God. That's in 1 John chapter 3. So there's a knowledge that's actually is effectually saving. That's the point that where I'm coming from. And so that's so Josh and I would really disagree on that. However, I do honor my brother when he mentions the warnings. There are over 80 so warnings in the Bible that, you know, warns believers to basically persevere in the faith, to not fall away. And that is there for a reason, because, you know, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And that puts the fear in our hearts so that we will persevere, we run this race hard, and we go on. And so for both Josh and I would even right now, on behalf of the both, for the both of us, I would just preach the gospel of Jesus Christ to you all. The gospel is this, that you all have, that you and I have fallen short of the glory of God. We have done things that have dishonored each other. We have dishonored our parents. We have lied. We have cheated. We have committed adultery. Well, you might say, I've never committed adultery, but I would say to you, as Jesus says, whoever looks at a woman with lust in his eyes has already committed adultery. Now, what's the solution? If I were to stand before a holy God right now, he would judge me. He would judge my soul. And he would say, you have sinned against me and against my people. You have sinned. You have sinned against each other. And so, what am I supposed to do? God is not going to just simply forgive you, because he's not going to simply forgive you, because he is a just God. Shall not the judge of all the earth do right? And the solution is this: because God is going to judge me for my sin, there's somebody who is going to come in my place. And that, both Josh and I would agree, is the penal substitutionary atonement of Christ. That Christ died for your sins. Regardless of if you're elect or not, find your election in Jesus Christ. That's my answer to you tonight. Your election is not going to be found in, oh, I don't know if I'm elect or not. If you realize that you're lost, and you realize that you know, you need to be saved. Both Josh and I would say the same thing to you. Come unto me, all ye who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am meek and lowly at heart, and you shall find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Jesus Christ offers himself in your place, that he died so that... So here's the thing. Jesus lived a perfect life on this earth. He lived it on your behalf. You and I, we have a bad record before an infinitely holy God. And we cannot stand before him. The only way that we could ever stand before him is if we trust in Christ. We say to Jesus Christ, Lord, I'm going to trust in you that you died to pay my sin debt. And that I'm trusting you to reveal yourself to me in your time and in your way. I believe that Christ will reveal himself to you in that manner, and he will give you a new heart and a new spirit. You don't have to try to clean yourself up. You don't have to follow a set of rules to earn God's favor. No, God already favors you through the death and burial, and resurrection of Christ. So that is, both Josh and I would say that to you. Christ died for you, he was buried for you, and he was raised for you. He took the penalty of your sins and your crimes before a holy God so that I can be clean. I can walk free now. I don't have to live a life of sin anymore. And now I have Christ's perfect record clothed on me. That's what the Bible says, being clothed in the righteousness of Christ. And in that, God will save you to the uttermost. And so both Josh and I, as much as we disagree on these issues, him and I will say the same thing. Jesus Christ died for you. That's the only answer. If some of you don't even know, if some of you are, you know, feeling this need and you need to be saved, I ask that you would run to Christ at this moment. Josh and I would say, run to Christ. That is repentance in itself. You don't have to try to clean yourself up. It is completely, completely a work of grace. Josh and I would agree on that. It is totally a work of grace. He takes out the heart of stone. He gives you a heart of flesh. He justifies. He glorifies. And God can declare you righteous today. And yeah. And so, Joshua Lloyd Parker, I really thank you for doing this debate with me tonight. I honor you as my brother. I learned a lot from tonight, and some of the things that you have said have humbled me. So, thank you for... So, huh?
I said me also.
All right. Well, anyways, Josh, thank you for coming on to Worldviews.
You're welcome. Would I be able to use some of my 6 minutes to do a closing prayer? Would that be all right?
Yeah, sure. You can, there's a...
I won't be a six-minute-long prayer. I just
go ahead. You can pray, please.
Lord, we just thank you for your word and that it is truth, Lord. I pray above all that your truth would prevail in our hearts, God, that you would... You would truly bring us to a place of, as Mikey said, humility, Lord Jesus, that we wouldn't be arrogant, Lord Jesus, that you're not out to hurt our pride, we're out to kill it, Lord. So I ask God that you would kill all pride in us right now. I pray for those who are watching, Lord, that you would encourage them and strengthen them in their faith, Lord Jesus. God, that you'd give them a joy in your word and knowing you, Lord. I pray that you would give them steel on the inside, that you would strengthen their inner man, Lord Jesus, God. I pray, God, that your grace, Lord Jesus, would enable them to live holy lives, to go out and to know, to make you known, Lord Jesus, yes. And to know you, Lord. I just pray, God, that there would be such a satisfaction in the gospel, in their hearts, that the gospel of peace would truly come to them, Lord, and with the same comfort that they've been comforted with, Lord, that they would be able to give to others, Lord. I thank you, Lord, that you've set the captives free, that we were once dead, and now we're alive, Lord. So I just pray, God, that for every person watching, Lord Jesus, God, that you says your spirit is a spirit of truth, Lord. So I just pray, God, that your spirit of truth would prevail above all else, Lord, and that you would make yourself known to all of us. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. And Father God, I just come before you at this time. I really respect my brother Josh here, who really knows the fear of the Lord. And God, I ask that for the both of us, that you would work a repentant heart in us that constantly seeks after your face, that does not turn away from you. Lord, we need to, both of us need to constantly depend on you every day, to know that you died for us, and to know that it's not a work of our own, but by grace and grace alone that we can live. And so, Father, I just really thank you. I pray that you will humble me, just really break me, God, after this debate. I know that many times my heart can be so deceitful. My heart can be so proud and very easy just to want to win a debate. But God, I really learned so much from Josh today. He really knew what he was saying, and God, he was really trying to honor you with his word, with your word. So Lord, help us all at this time to honor you in each and every day of our lives. And this is an in-house debate, God, but as much as we disagree On these things, God, we agree on the essentials that you died for us. So, Lord, we ask this all in the name of Christ. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Well, Joshua Lloyd Parker, thank you so much for joining me on Worldviews once again. In the next couple of episodes, I'll be discussing, in the next couple of episodes, I will be discussing the issue of ISIS and the ISIS and its rippling effect in the Middle East. And that's all for today. If you want, please subscribe onto my YouTube channel. And also, you can find me on Facebook as Mikey Liao, M-I-K-E-Y space L-I-A-O. That's this edition of Worldviews. Thanks for watching. Take care.